Hello everybody, it's that time again. Can you believe you're here at episode 6 of Breaking Bread? Man, what an awesome journey it's been. You know, through Adam, Brother Diabald, Brother Harvey, Brother Joe, just bringing the word, you know, and seeing how everything just fits in together and seeing Jesus come alive out of this word. Man, what an awesome time to be alive. You know, what an awesome time to be in. You know, we're already at day 13 of this lockdown, and we don't know whether it's just going to be for 21 days or whether it's going to be longer. You know, but that doesn't matter, because you know what's coming up? This weekend's coming up. The weekend that Jesus came and died for us. The weekend that Jesus was slaughtered for us. The weekend that Jesus died and rose from the dead and defeated the enemy. That he took up his cross, you know, and carried it and was hung on it, so that we can live at a time like this. For me, it's such an important time. It's such an important weekend. It's a weekend that I know where the Lord took me, Jesus took me out of a dark place and gave me the light and put me in the light. So for me, it's such an important time. For me, the cross like this is such an important thing. The blood of Jesus, it's such an important thing. You know, without the blood of Jesus, we are absolutely nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing. You know, the Lord's laid on my heart to build a cross again and start walking with it again. But it compares nothing to what he did for us. Nothing, absolutely nothing. So man, let's just go into it. Today I'm going to speak to you about the cross and about the blood of Jesus. You know, it's sad to sometimes see that when we have communion, that people make jokes of wine and things like that. Oh, this kind of wine is the blood of Jesus for communion or something. We don't understand the power that is within the blood. I'm going to touch on that. I'm going to go through that. Let's start off with Isaiah 53. Let me read this from verse 3. Sorry, from verse 4. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. So the peace we've got is upon him, is with him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So even though we are lost and we've turned our own way, God knew this. He still laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened up not his mouth. So even though that he was oppressed and afflicted, he said nothing. He still pushed through. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent. So he opened up not his mouth. Still he didn't open up and say anything. Even though he could do anything, because he's God. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people, he was stricken. Wow. How awesome is that? You know, there's such power in the blood of Jesus. And let's look at it. You know, the blood of Jesus is God's power source for our salvation and freedom. So without him shedding that blood, without him being prepared to be bruised, to be slaughtered, as it says here, going into slaughter, we would not have salvation or freedom. The next point is the blood can wash away every sin we ever committed, if we believe it and we claim it. So no matter what we've done, it can wash us clean, if we believe it and we declare it. Doesn't mean we can keep on doing it, no. It means we are set free and we need to turn from our way and go the other way. The atoning blood gave us right standing to be accepted to God. So because of the blood, we are right standing with the one and only God, the one and only God, our Father. Jesus gave his blood freely for us. Out of his great love, he bled in 7 places, and 7 is a significant number to God. Those 7 places we're going to touch on now. The blood of Jesus overcomes and defeats the worldly power of Satan and his demons. that come against us to rob, steal, and destroy our lives. Man, the blood of Jesus overcomes and defeats the worldly power of Satan. So because of the blood, we can walk in victory against Satan. We can walk in victory against anything. I'm going to touch on that now. So where was the first place that Jesus bled for us? It was in the Garden of Gethsemane. You know, the word says the following. It says in Luke 22 verse 44, it says, "And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground." Man. And out of this, what did Jesus' blood out of this then redeemed our willpower, and that Adam surrendered to Satan in the Garden of Eden. Because he said here as well as he said, "Not as I will, but as you will." So because of that blood, you know, you must be in such tremendous stress to sweat blood. Such tremendous stress. You know, but still Jesus pushed through. He still went through. And he gave us back willpower so that we can have willpower to overcome the enemy through his blood. He gave it back to us in that garden. The next part is, he was bruised for our iniquities. In Isaiah 53, verse 5, it says, "He was bruised, crushed for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him." You know, if we think about it, it says, so through him being bruised, it broke every iniquity. And what does that mean? Let me read something to you. It says, "Jesus was beaten almost beyond recognition to break the generational curse that runs in all of our bloodlines. He was bruised, which meant that he bled inside to wash away the iniquities of past generations and to give all of mankind a clean slate." Man, so because of that, I can be free. You can be free. We can be free of past things that happen. Our insides can be healed from the inside because he was bruised and beaten and bled from the inside. You know, in Isaiah 53 verse 10, it says the following, "Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteousness servant shall justify many, for he shall bear the iniquities." Man, thank you, Jesus. Then the next part. Is he was whipped. But first of all, he was crowned. He was whipped and scourged at the post. Why? Because by his stripes we are healed of sickness and disease. It says, for in 1 Peter 2 verse 24, it says, "Who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes and wounds you are healed." So let me tell you something quickly. In this sickness, in this time of sickness, you are healed by the stripes of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus. That is why he got whipped for us, so that we can have healing. So declare that healing over you. Declare that time over you. It is healing. You've got it. You've been bled. He's bled that blood for us so that we can live and have healing in Jesus' name. The next part is, they put a crown of thorns, was driven into Jesus' head. Why? Why is this so significant for us? It breaks the curse of poverty and releases us into God's abundance. Because in Genesis 3 verse 17 and 18 it says, "Cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat, so what happens when they put that thorns in his eyes? By the sweat of his brow, by the blood that was running from his brow. You shall eat bread till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. So what does it give to us? The Savior of all mankind was humiliated and mocked, beaten and bruised, all for us, the ones who deserved it. Crowned with great suffering, with twisted thorns piercing his brow, Jesus broke the curse on our livelihood for poverty, debt and lack. God cursed the ground that provided Adam, his living, and Jesus reversed the curse by the blood that was shed from the crown of thorns. By breaking this curse, the body of Christ can truly experience the promise of land flowing with milk and honey. Man. So maybe it's time we get out of this poverty mentality as well, because Jesus bled through thorns that went into his head so that we won't go through this poverty, so that we don't have to worry. But if we put our trust within God, you know, it's a time where we're worrying, you know, how are we going to get money? You know, oh, am I still going to have my job? It's just, I've gone to the shops and things are ridiculously more expensive. You know, you walk out of there with 3 bags and it's over 500-600 grand. You know, but yeah, Jesus gives us that promise. He bled for us so that we will prosper if we put our trust within him. Man, that's awesome. His hands were pierced by nails. What did this give us? It restored total dominion over the earth to the works of our hands. He was wounded, Isaiah 53 verse 5. He was wounded, pierced for our transgressions. Isaiah 49 verse 15, 16. It says, can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Surely they may forget, yet I will not forget. See, I have inscribed you. Listen, I've inscribed you on the palms of my hands. We are there with him. Not only did the blood flow from the hands of Jesus, but the anointing of God's Holy Spirit that breaks the yoke of bondage placed upon us because of sin flows from his hands. He laid hands on the sick and they were healed. He gave us back that. He touched the dead and they were raised. The very power of the throne of God flowed from the Savior's heart to those that cried out for his tender mercy. So he gave us back that again. Next one is one of my favorites as well. Through his feet was nailed to the cross. Why did he bleed through his feet? What has that blood part given back to us? It restored total dominion to everywhere our feet walk, and that we would prosper everywhere we go. Galatians 2 verse 15 says the following. It says, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So when we walk, we declare that the blood of Jesus flows through our feet so that we can take back that ground. It's always, most of the times, in my prayer, wherever we go, so that the blood of Jesus flows through our feet so that that ground can be taken back. So we can take back ground. We can take back ground. And the last part, a spear was thrust into his side. The spear, the Roman pike, pierced his heart, broke the heart sac when it was pierced, and healed our broken hearts from despair, from depression, from sadness, from grief, from anger, and the list just goes on, so that we can live in peace and joy. His heart was broken for us. Man, that's a God. That is Jesus. You know, in John 19 verse 34 it says, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. Isaiah 61 verse 1 says the following, he has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound. Man, what an awesome God. What an awesome God. Let me tell you something. Jesus, when he came and he did all of this, you can see it. He didn't do it in half measures. He fully paid the price for us. Isn't it time that we don't serve him in half measure, but serve him fully with what we've got? The word says, because you are lukewarm, I will vomit you out. The question we need to ask today, are we lukewarm? Does this blood mean something to me? Yeah, the blood of Jesus and the death of him, where his blood flowed for us, shows that we can walk in victory. Are you walking in victory? Am I walking in victory? Am I serving him in half measure? It's time we come back that we serve him in full measure. You know, I'm so glad that alcohol is banned now. You know, that now this weekend coming up, this Passover weekend, it's not going to be a weekend of partying and drinking and doing what we need to do. But now it can actually become a weekend of listening and seeing and spending and, you know, celebrating what Jesus did for us. Look at what he did for us. Look at what he did for us. My challenge to you is, I'm not going to lead you in a salvation prayer or anything like that. You need to do it. It's by faith that we can live. It is by faith that we can have eternal life. It's by faith. You need to believe this, that it's true, that he died for you to have everlasting life. Take a time. Take your time and do it. And if you don't do it before Friday, do it on Friday. You know, have communion. Have communion. Why do we need to have communion? This is such an interesting passage. It's quite a hard passage, but it's such a good passage. Why do we have to have communion? You know, and I believe that if you make that decision to fully serve him, you know, we can't fully serve him and say we fully serve him, but back at the ranch, we're still busy beating our wives, kicking people around, swearing at everyone, you know, doing things that we should not do, and saying, but I believe in God. Jesus did not do half measure. It's time to fully, fully serve him. The word says in John verse 6, from verse 53, it says, then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So it's just coming to mind now. You know, we've got all this doom and gloom stuff, and it's the end of time. So what if it's the end of time? Then at least we get to go to heaven. But think about this. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood and has eternal life, I will raise him up at the last day. So if we are part of Jesus, he will raise us up. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me, on Jesus, will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven. Not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. That's dead stuff that's happening. He who eats this bread will live forever. So I think it's time to do communion properly. Do it. Do it on Friday. I challenge every single one of you. Do it on Friday. Do it with your family. Have communion. Eat a piece of bread. Drink a bit of juice. Juice you can go and buy. Bread you can go and buy. Take the bread as his body. Take the juice as his blood. And have part of him and see what happens within your life. I challenge you to do that. And you will have eternal life. He who eats this bread will live forever. Man, that's awesome. It's been blessed. Challenge you to do it. To go out and know that you have the seven steps. You are fully, fully saved from each and every single thing. Because of Jesus' blood, we have no excuse anymore. So bless you. I hope this message blessed you. I've now got a surprise. Engela Potgieter has written us a Fish and Bread original song for this time, which I'm going to play you now. And what I love about this song is it's nice and raw. It's her that recorded it, wrote it with the guitar, taped it, or recorded it off her phone. And man, it's raw. Here's the first peek of it. I know this is going to be a song that's going to be developed, but here's a part of it. Bless you all. Let me pray for you. Father, I just want to pray for each and every single person here. Thank you, Jesus, that you came and died for us so that we can celebrate this time, so that we can live. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. And I ask that you will cover each and every single one of us with the blood of Jesus. Because with the blood, we are free. Bless each and every single person that are here. Keep them safe. Be with them. Holy Spirit, remind them of this word. And let this word grow. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. We love you. Amen. Well, that's the end. Bless you all. Have an awesome weekend. And remember, it's all about the blood. Up next is going to be Brother Adam. And let's just enjoy it. Love you all. Bye.
I declare healing over my family. I make known that we're protected by His blood. The enemy has been defeated. God, you crush Satan beneath my feet. I declare freedom to every mind that is sent free. Trample snakes and scorpions and they don't harm me. I see your peace fall like a blanket over every bit of fear that's held us bound. But most of all, I just wanna praise my my heart